Men who caught and sang the sun in flight and learned too late they grieved it on its way.
Sends shivers, doesn't it? Mm. It's lovely. Joining us now is Gabriel Heaton, who's a specialist in English literary manuscripts at Sotheby's. Welcome. And John Goodby, who's Professor of English at Swansea University and an authority on Dylan Thomas. Lovely to have you both with us.
Thanks.
Let's talk about this. Yes. There's such a story behind how this was found.
There is, yes. It just came in to us off the street. I mean, obviously we have, you know, people bring in all sorts of wonderful things to Sotheby's, but for someone to bring in something as extraordinary as this without any indication that it was something special is incredibly unusual.
And who was he who brought it in?
Well, it was the great niece of someone who had in the 1930s worked for Dylan Thomas's mother-in-law.
Okay, so that's actually quite tenuous, isn't it? But it's something that had been passed, presumably, from family member to family member.
Yeah, well, what had happened is that the Dylan Thomas's mother-in-law had given this to, you know, the owner's great-aunt, asking her to burn it, to throw it in the kitchen boiler. She decided not to do that and to keep it. She just put it away, rather forgot about it, and it just passed down in the family ever since, and no one had really thought very much about it.
Right.
So, Professor, this is the first time it's been seen publicly, and when you look at it, as somebody who has an expertise in this area, when you see something like this, explain the significance.
Well, first of all, I can hardly keep my hands off it. It's that exciting. It's significant because we know of four other notebooks that run from April 1930 through to April 1934, kept between Dylan Thomas's roughly 15th year and his 19th. We knew that there were other notebooks, but they'd probably disappeared because he describes having 10 notebooks to one of his correspondents, Henry Treece. But they'd been written off because Thomas sold these four notebooks that are at University of Buffalo now, along with one notebook full of short stories, in 1941. So it's that long since these came on the market.
Looking at that, you see all these crossings out, and it's quite messy, really, isn't it? Which is like a work in progress. Is that what we're looking at?
Absolutely, and the messier the better, as far as scholars are concerned, because that shows Dylan Thomas revising and the processes of his imagination, the way that his mind works, the way that his poetry emerges. That's why this is significant, because there's so much crossing out, paradoxically. So this continues from where the four notebooks left off, from the middle of 1934 through to the middle of 1935. It's almost like the missing piece of a jigsaw for his early poetry. It's fantastic.
Gabriel, you said that his mother-in-law just said, oh, throw it away. I mean, does that give us, and do we care about this insight into his life? I mean, I just wonder if it would have been reflected in any of his work. Or,
well, we do, by pure coincidence. We actually have a letter in the same auction on the 9th of December, written by Dylan Thomas right about the time that he was that this notebook was lost, and in which he complains about his, you know, he's staying with his mother-in-law, and he says, I'm here, you know, in this horrible town, in a horrible village in England, and I sit in the toilet hating my mother-in-law. So that, you know, there was tension, but I mean, maybe not the only occasion when someone hasn't got on with their mother-in-law.
Without wishing to be too crude about it, the value, I mean, it clearly has huge historical importance, literature, in terms of literature, but I mean, is Dylan Thomas stuff is valuable?
Of course, he's one of the greatest, you know, one of the most loved poets of the 20th century. Mm. He's enormously, he's enormously attractive to many people for many different reasons, and he's hugely appealing, and that's reflected in the commercial value of things like manuscripts and.
John, where would you like to see a piece like this end up? I mean, where would a good place for it to be?
Well, the National Library of Wales, or the British Library, or maybe in Buffalo, where the other four notebooks are. Where scholars can access it, I would like. You know, even if it goes into private hands, I would like those to be, hands that allowed scholars to look at it occasionally. That would, you know, be my preference.
How valuable is something like this to you in the general sense? Because perhaps this could inspire people to just have a look around, think about their ancestry and if they had any contact with anyone of any literary note.
It's valuable because, as I say, it's the missing piece in jigsaw. And Thomas is a crucial mid-20th century poet, and maybe his value as an important poet, as a serious poet, hasn't been fully reflected in the last few years. He's always been a popular poet, as Gabriel said, but he hasn't been taken terribly seriously by scholars for about the last 30 or 40 years, and now I think he's coming into his own again. And so the discovery of this notebook actually gives a bit of oomph to that rediscovery process. You know, it's just a great thing to have appeared at this time.
Well, thank you very much for bringing it for us this morning on its own little cushion.
We're not allowed to touch it.
I'm afraid not.
Good to see you both. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks.